Herzlichen guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren, liebe Freunde des Hauses. Wir haben heute die ganz schöne Gelegenheit, hier in der Kunsthalle, mit der uns eine schöne Nachbarschaft verbindet, diese Veranstaltung zu machen. Das ist eine Veranstaltungsserie, die wir eigentlich jetzt begründen wollen, nämlich eine Vortragsreihe, die wir in Zusammenarbeit mit der Müller-Mehland-Stiftung in Basel organisieren, die uns hier großzügig unterstützt, mit dem Wunsch, einen Architekturdiskurs anzuregen, der neue Gesichter der internationalen Architektur in die Diskussion einführt. Es geht um die Vorstellung, vielleicht mal nicht Star-Architekt X oder Y zu präsentieren, sondern vielleicht einen wichtigen Architekten oder eine wichtige Architektin der Zukunft rauszupicken. Jemanden, von dem man das Gefühl hat, der hat das Potenzial oder die hat das Potenzial, mal ganz wichtig zu werden, was Neues zu präsentieren, einen Impuls zu geben, den man sich so nicht vorgestellt hätte. Etwas, was vielleicht unpredictable ist, unvorhersehbar. Also wir wollen eigentlich in dieser Reihe, die jährlich einmal einen Vortrag stattfinden lassen wird und einmal einen Architekten oder Architektin präsentieren wird. Vielleicht könnte man das so sagen, die Stars von morgen präsentieren, obwohl natürlich dieses ganze Konzept des Starseins auch so ein bisschen irgendwie in die Jahre gekommen ist. Und eigentlich geht es mehr darum, nicht Celebrity zu inszenieren, sondern eigentlich Importance and Influence. Für dieses erste Mal haben wir uns eine Architektin ausgesucht und wahrscheinlich müsste ich jetzt mal auf Englisch umschalten, weil unsere Referentin zufällig nicht Deutsch spricht. For this first event, we have selected Marina Tabassum, who is an architect that I only started to know about a couple of months ago. And a friend, Niklaus Graber, who is here, an architect from Lucerne, Graber Steiger Architects, showed me a work from architects from Bangladesh when I visited him in his office that just blew me just apart, really. It blew my mind. And I had the feeling, wow, there is an absolutely contemporary, vibrant architectural scene of which I have no clue at all. How is that possible? There's really excellent work, and if any of this, if any of these projects would have been done by some Western architect, it would have received a lot of attention. And it isn't, because our architectural media obviously have a certain bias and focus, which is normal, because we exist local in a global world. But I thought, wouldn't it be interesting to actually introduce someone from this scene into our discourse, so that we can get a sense of what's happening elsewhere and ask ourselves how this type of architectural production may reflect on our type of work, on our understanding of architecture. Maybe it helps us to contextualize the things that we hold important. When we hear somebody who works in a condition that is entirely different, what does it mean to work as an architect in a city of 17 million inhabitants? This is Dakar, the city that Marina Tabassum comes from, where she has her office. What does it mean to work in a practice, to work in a country that is struck by extreme poverty, exposed to natural disasters on a daily basis? What does it mean to work as an architect in a climate where the climate is so aggressive that it gives buildings a patina of age when they're half a year old already? What does it mean for architecture if you practice it in these kind of different conditions? And I've had the pleasure to meet her since then two times, once in Austria and now last week in Dubai, of all places. But there's a reason for this, because last week in Dubai were the award ceremonies of one of the most important architectural awards in the world right now, which is the Aga Khan Award for Architecture. This is an architecture prize that is dedicated to the Islamic world. It focuses on the Islamic world. It is very generously funded. It has a prize money of $1 million, which is given for a couple of projects. This year, 6 projects were awarded. Her project was one, which is a mosque, which is already kind of an insider's tip. She will talk about this project today, among others. But what basically is important to keep in mind that her work, even if we only will get to know about her work, is really embedded in this kind of contemporary scene in Bangladesh. And it is also embedded in a tradition that is highly interesting, that goes back a couple of centuries. And maybe this is one of the most important qualities that I received from my exposure to Bangladesh architecture so far. That is the type of contemporary architecture that has managed a way to actually find its sources both in contemporary sources, like Western modernism, stuff that's happening here, but also in buildings that were built in Bangladesh 6 centuries ago. And I was wondering, is there any kind of contemporary architecture in Europe or the Western world where I could say the same? And I had the feeling no. So the just as a as an to contextualize this lecture, this is like an anticipation of an exhibition that we are going to make next year. Actually, in a year from now, we will do an exhibition on contemporary Bangladesh architecture, because we got so excited and said this is the time to do it, because in 5 years all these people will be famous and we want to be the first ones to put them on the map. So to give you excuse me, a little bit of an introduction to the person of Marina Tabassum and her work, I would like to ask Niklaus Graber on the stage, because he is the person that put us together and who introduced me to her work. And Niklaus, please come to the stage.
So, good evening, and most of all, a warm welcome to our honorable speaker tonight, Marina Tabassum. And of course, congratulations for the Aga Khan Award 2016. I'm very happy to see you here, and not in Dhaka this time. I have been there several times and always received very warmly by Marina and his colleagues. And I'm very happy that now she made the way to be here, and you can all appreciate her work tonight. So I have the honor to introduce you shortly to the audience, to tell a little bit about your background and your career so far. Marina Tabassum graduated in 1995 from Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology with distinction. During the formative years of her career, she was greatly influenced by Masrul Islam, the pioneer of modern tropical architecture in Bangladesh. His philosophy of responsible architecture practice that not only impacts the physical environment, but also become a source of positive change in the world, is also something she tries to promote through her work and teaching. From 1995 till 2005, Marina Tabassum was a partner at Urbana, a practice jointly founded with Kashef Chowdhury in Dhaka. In 1997, second year into Tabassum's architectural career, Urbana won the prestigious national competition to design the Independence Museum of Bangladesh and the Liberation War Museum. Both buildings have been completed finally in 2013. In 2005, Marina Tabassum founded her own practice, Marina Tabassum Architects, MTA, in Dhaka. The practice is consciously kept in an optimal size, and projects are undertaken are carefully chosen and are limited by number per year. As you will see later, the projects done and at hand are ranging from master planning to industrial buildings, eco resorts, low-cost housing, a mosque, and also a residential block. Besides her practice, Marina Tabassum is intensely involved in academic. Marina teaches design studio at Brac University in Dhaka since 2005 and was a visiting faculty at the University of Asia Pacific, also in Dhaka. She taught advanced design studio as a visiting professor at UT Arlington in 2015. And Marina Tabassum is currently the academic director of Bengal Institute for Architecture, Landscape and Settlement in Dhaka. Now, I would like to leave the stage free for you, Marina. Thanks again for coming and welcome again.
Thank you, Nicolaus. That was generous. And thanks to Andreas for inviting me to do this lecture. And thank you all for being here. I mean, in Bangladesh, in this weather, when you have cold and rain at the same time, nobody would show up, I can promise you. But I'm sure it's something you're used to. So thank you all for being here. So generally, the way I do, I'll probably do the same way. I mean, I don't know how much you know about Bangladesh, so I'd rather start with explaining a little bit of geography, because that is something important to understand before I go into the projects that I will show you today. So Bangladesh is basically, if you see, this is the Himalayan range, like your Alps, beautiful. I had a chance to see a glimpse of it today when I was in Lucerne. But right underneath this Himalayan range, especially there are two major rivers that come out of it. One is the Brahmaputra, and the other one is the Ganges. And as they combine and flows into the Bay of Bengal, it basically creates a delta. So the Ganges Delta, which is actually the largest delta in the world, is where I come from. So my country is actually two-thirds a delta. And it has been created by accumulation of silt over time. And so basically what it is, if you see here, there are numerous rivers as these rivers basically go into the Bay of Bengal. It creates a lot of tributaries and rivers. And these rivers are fairly large. And what happens is we also fall into a place which is subtropical. We have a long monsoon seasons. So our land, during the monsoon season, which is summer and monsoon when there's a lot of rain, it remains flooded. There's a lot of water. And then again, during the winter time, which is a dry season, it becomes land. So what is water? Land at some point in time. So there is this land and water dynamics that exists in the land. The earth, as I said, that it's a delta, so it's very soft. It's so soft, and these mighty rivers, when they decide to change their courses, it erodes. So the banks erode constantly, and then again it emerges in some other places. Okay, let's go from this slide to the next. So the land is basically very fertile because it's silt. It's constantly renewed by this water that comes in. So, you know, it's almost like you throw some seeds, it would definitely pop out some trees like a magic. So it's a very fertile soil. And because we have so many rivers, other than agriculture, it's also a place where we have a lot of fishing. So there's one happy fisherman for you. And it's also a place where the nature and life is very closely interlinked. And as I said, it's a delta. Our building material has always been earth. It's everything is made out of mud and earth. So we have two-story residential buildings made out of earth. So all the vernacular that you see are made out of earth. We don't have any stone as such. And if you look into our architecture from the 3rd century or 2nd century BC, this is an image of a Buddhist monastery during that time, where earth was baked into brick and used to build something which is much more permanent. This you can see, it's again terracotta, intricately curved out of earth, baked. And this has been there for quite a lot of long time and centuries. Our language, which is Bengali or Bangla, has its root in the Sanskrit. So, and it has also been had a, we have a long history and a pretty rich culture of it. So I will go start with a project, which is, for that I have to give you a little background of how Bangladesh came into being. So if you see these two maps here, these are the red one. This is during the British colonial time when the whole Indian subcontinent was under British rule. And this maps actually, which was done in 1909, this red map shows the Hindu population in the Indian subcontinent. The darker the red is the denser the Hindu population. And this one actually shows the density of Muslim population. So the darker the green area, those are the places where Muslims were concentrated. And based on this, during 1947, when British left India, they basically divided the whole subcontinent into three parts. And this was done in only 2 weeks or 3 weeks of time. So the borders were drawn very harshly. Somebody's house was like divided into two parts. The bathroom was on one side and the house was on the other side. Nobody really cared. But it's also one of the point when the largest mass migration of people happened. And if you see here, Bengal also got divided. And this is the map of Bengal. And from there, Bangladesh was basically carved out. This was not Bangladesh at that time, it was East Pakistan. And my family actually comes from this little pocket here, which actually is a predominantly Muslim area, but went into Indian part. So they had to leave everything and come to Dhaka, which is right here, to make this traveling, and which meant that it had to be done in a day. And they basically left everything behind. And all I have is, as a reminiscence of what the past or the route was, this is a base of a hookah. I don't know if you know hookah. It's something like a smoking device, right? So that's what we have left. So if you look here, that's the Indian subcontinent, and that's how it was divided. So this became East Pakistan, this is West Pakistan, and in between them is the Indian land, which is 1,600 kilometers. And between East and West, there was hardly any, except for the fact of religion, there was nothing in common. We spoke two different languages, we had very different culture. So since 47, 48 onwards, it was a time of struggle. So for 23 years, it was just a time where nobody could see each other, in a certain way that, so basically what resulted was a revolution. And in 1971, this is very important because that's the place where my project is located, that's the site. And in 1971, 7th of March, this is our leader of the nation, we call Sheikh Mujibur Rahman. He basically said that now what we struggle or our fight is for our freedom. And which led to a war, a civil war. And it was a 9 month long intense war, which ended in December the same year, and Bangladesh became a sovereign country. And this site, which I just showed you, where this ground, this also has a history that started from the Mughal times. In the Mughal time, it used to be a garden, It was known as Shahbagh. And then later on, during the British time, this was used as a race course, which you can see here. And nowadays, it's used more as an Occupy movement or any kind of activity that is the city generates. This is where people gather to voice their opinion. So this is a very important place in the city overall scene. So in 1997, as Andreas was mentioning, that there was a competition for a national monument commemorating this war and our independence, and also a museum for that, which was after, say, our war was in 1971, and this one is 1997, which is about 26 years afterwards. And the site, as I showed you, that was the site. It made relevance, of course, the fact that it was a very historically important place. But it's also one of the most important parks of the city. So if you see, this is Dhaka. And you see that it's water all around. There's a river down here. And it's also another river that actually makes it. So this is this point and that point and all the water body on the sides. And if you see this little green patch here is our parliament complex done by Louis Kahn. And my site is actually right here. So this is one of the last living green spaces which people can enjoy. So when the competition came to us and we thought, you know, another building in a park, really? I mean, that would probably destroy the whole thing. So our idea was to go for the minimum footprint. And if you see how densely built Dhaka City is, and this is the park that we had, and this is the site. So what we did was try to go for the minimumist footprint that was possible. So this is what we have here. Tried to keep the horizontality of the place by just creating a plaza. So that's what you see. It's 1926. I just downloaded it yesterday. So so this is what we did. This is a children's park that is still there. And that's basically the park. What we did is we just took a very minimal footprint that is absolutely required for the museum complex. And we added a walkway around it, an amphitheater. And the way we basically generated the whole thing is that it's a journey. It's a journey into the how you go from struggle to the monument. So this is the final monument which is there. And you start as a journey where you have, in the beginning is the 7th March speech commemorating a small token relic. In the center, there is a water feature, which is a water body. I'll show you maybe in the 3Ds better. That's the water feature in the middle, which is actually abstractly representing the 9-month-long war. And what it does is there's a small central hole, and the water basically draws into that space. And at the end is the tower. So once you go up, before you go to the tower, you take this wall, and then you go down into the museum, which is actually below grade. So that's the section. So you through the wall, you go down, you have the museum here, and then once you've gone through the museum, you come up, and then you go to the tower. So if you see, this is showing you all the different parts. That's the central water body, and that's the main central chamber in the middle. So this project, actually, we were commissioned in 1998, and we finally finished it in 2013. That's about 16 years of going through this whole struggle of bringing this project to an end, because it's a government project, a public project, and when one of the government is interested in it, the other one is not. So when the power shift happened, the project got stalled. So anyway, finally, in 2013, we were able to finish it. So this is what it looks like now. So we have the tower and the water body. So if you go into the museum, these are the ramps that take you down. You have an audiovisual room on this side, the central chamber, and then again, you come up from there. I'll just go through the images, then probably it's easier to understand. As I said, that it took 16 years. The project was sitting there for a long number of years, just incomplete. So if you the building actually captures the history of what has gone through it. So, and we thought, you know, that's the history of a building coming to a shape, so it should retain the way it is. So we did not do anything to it, so you'll see all the marks, because we have a lot of rain and it's monsoon time. It sort of gets deteriorated if you do not take care of it. So you'll see all these marks that are already there in the building. And we thought, you know, that's the history of its making and it should remain with it. So that's the first part of the exhibition. And we have everything printed on glass, all the history, because the government never made any initiative of collecting all the documents. So what we have are just photographs. So we basically took the photographs, printed them on glass, and we made exhibits out of that. And so that's what you see here. So it's like walking through the memories. And then you come to this place, which is kind of dark space where we have all the images of genocide and torture. And from there you enter into that central space where the water is drawing in and throwing into that little... So it's basically a water fountain, or you could say a tower that is commemorating the loss of life and struggle that has gone through to actually attain what is freedom. And the way we basically depict this is the fact that, you know, when you have aspirations, freedom, dream, they always tend to go upward. So that's why the plaza is for that reason, that you have a celebration, it's on the plaza. But when you come down to the museum, it's about the sadness and memory, and it's about urging the subterranean in a way. So that's how we kind of try to deal with the duality that exists in our freedom. So as you go up, basically these are the spaces, different kind of spaces. This museum is not really a documentation museum in that sense. It's not a war museum either. So it's what it does is gives you a feeling. So before you go to the tower and understand the need of this, how important the freedom and independence is to us, it's about evoking a certain kind of a feeling before you actually go to that place. And since it's below grade, about 24 feet below grade, we tried to bring in light, natural light, as much as possible so that people don't feel claustrophobic. So then you go up, taking the ramps, and then you go to the tower. So the tower, which is actually the Independence Monument, it is designed as a tower of light. Essentially, we used glass as a material, but our intention was to capture the light. So what we have is a space frame structure in the middle, and you see glass cladded on the facade, on the side of it. And the glass was not designed as a sheet of glass. These are glass stacked one top of another to create a panel. So if you see, here, these are the glasses. So we stacked them, and then we made a panel out of it, and then these panels are clad onto the space frame structure. This is, if you look at it closely, that's what it is. The idea was that we will use the glass as a medium, where if you take in the daylight, it will refract through the medium of the glass, and it will give it an interesting glow. So since we have a bright sun, it generally does that, that in a nice bright sunny day, you see light being refracted through it. And in the evening, it gets lit by artificial light from the sides, so it glows like a tower. So it's basically a tower of light, a beacon of hope for a young nation. So hopefully, I mean, that really is something that people really enjoy. This is one of the occasions in celebration during our victory day, and you see the amount of people that is gathering there. So that's what you see in the city. So Bangladesh is actually, the Tropic of Cancer is cutting through Bangladesh, that's where it is. So in a way the climate is subtropical, and we have a high humidity during the summer months. So basically the rain comes in summer, and which is absolutely wonderful. We enjoy rain. We actually celebrate rain. It's a blessing for us because it's a summer rain, not a winter rain. And of course, it causes a lot of trouble as well. You can see flash flooding. It also creates flood, which is not so desirable. But then again, that's part of life, and we accept it as a certain way of living. This is not flood, but also water in a way that we celebrate. So as I said, rain is something we really celebrate, and water as well. So if you build in a climate like ours, where we have the summer months, which is of high humidity, all you basically need is a roof on your head. That's it. That's how simple architecture can be. And unlike yours here, where you need a layer and layer of insulations, we don't need anything. It's basically a roof to cover you, a high plinth perhaps, so that the water doesn't touch you in that sense when there is enough rain, and just to keep it open as possible. So this character of pavilion form is something that is very important for us. And more so because we have the flatness of our land, there is a lack of electricity. In a summer day, you might have 3 hours of no electricity. And then, you know, you need to think that your building needs to be designed in a way that you do not require air conditioning or anything of that sort, that you can survive without that. So that's something which is something we've always been thinking about, and building needs to operate on its own without being air conditioned, and also with light and ventilation. So this is a project, not mine. This is from 1952, a project which is probably the first modern, tropical modern building in Bangladesh, done by Mazhar al-Islam. And you can see that it's also about porosity and openness and that pavilion-like feeling. And one of my projects, which is also done very early in my, it was designed in 1997, 98, a very small apartment where this whole idea of tropicality and how to deal with the climate where we live was first explored, and then later on, sort of in a way, turned into a path or obsession in a way into my work of architecture. So it's about how you can keep your architecture open, embrace the nature, how it comes, and to give a space for nature to play. So it's a room that is there for nature to come in, rain to be celebrated, wind and everything. It's in a dense city, Dhaka, which is home to 20 million people. And in a building which was also designed by us, a developer project. So within that building, actually, this is the apartment. Actually, there are 4 apartments. This is the core. And that's actually the apartment that I'm showing you at the moment. What we have is a court, which is for the nature. It's a studio kind of an apartment, so it's about 120 square meter of space. And this is the sleeping area, this is the sitting area, this is the dining and kitchen, a bathroom. What we did was we tried to create a volume, which is the nature room, high volume, so that it creates what we call stack effect, that the hot air goes up and it creates a draft of air from all around. So, and that really worked well. As you see that this is the high volume here. And as the air goes hot, it tends to go up and it draws in air from all sides. And it creates a draft, which really keeps the space ventilated. And cross-ventilation is very necessary in a hot, humid climate. So that creates that draft of air, and which really did work so remarkably well that we did not need any air conditioning or even fan. Maybe for a very few, 1 week or 2 weeks of high heat, then you can probably think of a fan, but otherwise it was not needed. And this project is also kind of interesting because we used everything that you see here are recycled or repurposed. The bricks are sourced from old buildings that are torn down in the old part of the city. So all that you see, the brick here, it's all taken from old buildings. And so that's the high volume you can see from the top, the nature room, which opens up and sort of becomes one space with the inside and outside. And if you close the doors, the wooden doors, it can become a very comfortable space. And you can see the difference of the light. So I'll just go very quickly through the images. You see that we've used stone, travertine, which is an Italian stone. We don't get travertine in Bangladesh. No stone at all, as I said. And stones are very expensive to use. But this is a stone which we found from a, you know, small pieces, different kind of shapes and sizes from one of the hotel projects that was done there. And these were stones that were lying in their storage. So we just took them at a very low price. The problem or the challenge was basically how you fit them into this space. And so we, that was also kind of an interesting play to work with. You see how it's open on all sides? Now that's the kitchen where we used hammered copper, which is something is used as a for the utensils, you see there. You see the brick, how beautiful the bricks are. It's already 150 years old brick, salvaged. And it's almost stone. And that's the bathroom, again in brick. Some little details, that's a cupboard with a Dhaka City satellite image on it. A bit of Carlo Scarpa. So there is a lot of small details in this whole project because it was one of our first and we were very passionate about doing a lot of small details. So everything was done on site. So you can see the drawings were not even done in regular, you know, the way we are used to making drawings, but all sketches on sketchbooks. And as I was mentioning about the travertine, the different sizes and shapes, you can see all the different things. It was almost like a solving a puzzle. So there were squares, there's rectangles, all kinds of sizes and shapes. And probably that's what makes it kind of interesting. This is mosaic porcelain, which is also quite common in Bangladesh. So we use that in the bathroom. Not using tile, but something else. So as I was mentioning about this whole idea of porosity and breathability of a space, which is very important. It's one of our one project where we, it was a cotton, a boutique which actually sold cotton fabric. And cotton is a material which has this porosity that allows air to be breathed, you know, it breathes in and out. So from that, in a way, we created a certain idea. Also shows the obsession that had become of how you to deal with it. So also the shelves and everything was done in that way. So if you go very close to that cotton fabric or whatever you call that, see, that's another project where we actually dealt with that. This is a 9-square plan, and the corners are all open spaces, and including the center, and the rest of it is more or less spaces to use. This is a small weekend house which is on the outskirts of Dhaka. And here again you see that high volume which was created to have that stack effect. And this is the house and you see that's the main volume and all the corners are open so that it creates that draft of air. And here you see the brick being used and what we did was used brick dust and lime and had an interesting finish on top of it, so it actually helps to breathe the brick and at the same time gives it a unified look. And well, the brick wasn't of the best of quality, so you see all that imperfection, but unified in a way it gives a sort of a homogeneous look. So that's what it is. You see that's the one of the courts and it opens. The windows are more or less inside. the central atrium space, and which goes into the space which the other walls are pretty much white, and only that volume. On the top of it, it's all very pavilion-like spaces where people can just sit outside and embrace nature. One of the corner courtyards. So this is one similar kind of a project where we try to work with the skin, which is, again, breathable skin, and playing with light and shade and shadow. A small factory, also somewhere close to Dhaka, which had that kind of an effect. But the reason I show you is because when you have a section like this, which is quite common in Bangladesh, in Dhaka especially, which is a 20 million people city, and we have such a dense density that you need to build buildings which actually can cater to more people. So it's always about apartments. We do not have any houses as such. House would be luxury. And so it's always apartments. So if you go to Dhaka, you'll see a lot of apartment buildings, and that's what architects do, build apartments. So this is one project that I worked on, 12-story building, which is located in absolutely a very major spine of Dhaka city, which goes from north to south. In fact, one of the most important roads that is there, and always in traffic jam. So basically, that's the site right here. If you go close to it, that's the site, absolutely on the street. And you already see in Google Image that there is already a lot of cars, but most of the time it remains very, very jammed. So what do you do on a site like that when you have to build something of a floors stacked? In a single story building, probably it's easier. So what we did was, this was again a developer project, so developer meaning real estate development project. So what we have in the middle is the core, and we have two apartments on two sides. And we tried to open up the sides because we wanted the air to flow in and then flow out. So to create, again, the draft of air and breathable space so that the space can work on its own. And what you get is something like that. When you're sitting in a jam, at least you look at a facade which is kind of a public facade. What we tried to do is not to give you verandas with clothes hanging, which is quite a common fact, but to give you a facade which actually ventilates the building. At the same time, it gives you something which is more for public and for the city and not for the people, the 20 families that are living inside. So that's also something we try to work with. This building is very difficult to photograph because there's too many trees and a lot of wires. So yeah, this is what a developer's perspective would look like. Something when you look inside, the corners. So there are quite a few projects that we designed in a way to have this breathability of the facade. This is a brick kiln. And since brick is our material, that's what we build with. We don't, as I said, no stone. So there are a lot of brick kilns in the city, all around Bangladesh. And what now is happening is that you see a lot of hybrid Hoffman brick kilns, which actually emits less carbon into the atmosphere. So that actually becomes a CDM project, which is carbon trading projects. And for a project like that, which is, this is a brick kiln, so you don't ever see this inside of a brick kiln generally until you're going for it to see it in a construction phase because it gets totally filled with bricks. But it's an interesting space, which I found quite nice. And one of the project was about, you know, one of these Hoffman hybrid brick kiln. They wanted to have a small space where they could keep their guests right next to it to show that it doesn't actually emit that much of smoke and people can absolutely live there. So that's what actually led me to designing a project this is one of our Hindu temples that you see in our landscape, which is really beautiful. And from all of that brick kiln idea came this whole idea of creating this space, which is again very close to that idea of a brick kiln. That's the section and the elevation, the model. And right next to the brick kiln, this is what it was supposed to look like, but it did not get built. But it's an idea which I really cherish, and I'm now building it again in another location, not next to a brick kiln, but it's in a separate space. So I thought of showing it, though it's not a built project yet, but it's ongoing construction. This is a competition, not really, we won the competition, but we didn't get to build it, but I thought I would like to share. This is the embassy area of Dhaka. And you see, this is the American embassy. Let me go a little closer. This is the Canadian embassy, the Chinese embassy, Thai embassy, British embassy. The Swiss do not have an embassy site, but they have it in a building, which is kind of nice. It's beautiful. I went there to get my visa. So this is actually the site, which is for the French-German embassy, which is kind of interesting an idea. French and German, they decided to build an embassy together. And the French had the land, but the Germans did not. So the Germans paid for it. Sorry, Andreas. And the French actually owned the land. So it was a competition, and we took part in it. And the idea was that, you know, you saw the site. Basically, it's a kind of a squarish site. And as embassies are, they're a high security zone. So what they needed was 25 meters setback from all sides. So which sort of brought us to a point that it became a very minimal footprint. So we had to go high up. So that's what we came up with, a central atrium, cutting the corners, and then creating something interesting. And at the end, this is what our design was. So these are the low security areas, and all the high security zone was in that space. That's the passport and visa section. This is the cafeteria, the services. This is where the porch is, car parking for the ambassadors. And that's the basic space. So what we did was we created this, cut the corners in a way that to bring in light, and we had the atrium in the middle and the offices all on the sides. So if you look at the plan, you see that it just changes the corners in different directions. So what happens is it looks, only for the corners, because they didn't want anybody to look into the spaces. It had to be a very high security thing, so nobody from the street should be able to look into the space. So we created that in a way that you get light, ventilation, but then again, not much of a view. But that project did not actually got, I mean, we won first prize, then a French architect got the project. French embassy, yeah. Okay, so this is my grandmother. A relief for you after architecture. Well, the reason I show you my grandmother is because she was the client for this project, which is the mosque project, which got the award. In 2005, she actually commissioned me to do this project. It's actually to the northern part of Dhaka. So this is the end of Dhaka city here, and the mosque is located right there. And this area used to be farmland, so there was agriculture. And if you see 2004, when I got the project, it was pretty much farmland. People were still planting rice and paddy and whatnot. And in 2014, by that time, within 10 years' time, it was already filling up with buildings. That's where the mosque is. So basically, as the city is growing, and it's growing in a rapid speed, Dhaka is like a monster. It's growing like, I do not know if any other city is growing as fast as it is. So, and these areas which were already getting, becoming settlements, but the government did not yet took that into account or given them the facilities that were required. My grandmother, since our family owned some land there, decided to donate part of it to build this mosque. And well, mosque or any other religious structure, anything which has to do with spirituality is something, you know, I'm always ready to do. So that's the project which I became kind of really very close to my heart. And because it was something my grandmother gave as a responsibility to me. So I basically started investigating into what is mosque, what is Islamic, or what is the richness of Islamic architecture. I wouldn't call it Islamic architecture, but the Islamic culture that has the richness of it. You see Cordoba here, the mosque, which is a beautiful mosque, in my opinion. Hagia Sophia, not a mosque, a basilica, but still the spirituality and the light, the magic of light is just amazing. So these are projects which really inspired me. And if you look into the whole mosque architecture throughout how mosque came into being in history, you'll see that this is the first mosque of Islam. And it is just basically a space which is covered. Essentially a space which is designed as a space for congregation where Muslims come together and there's a certain direction which is chosen. At that time it was Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem. Later on it changed towards Kaaba. But that there's a certain direction and they all congregate and in a communion with God they basically pray. And mosques were not only built for praying, which is five times a day, but it was also a space where many other activities took place, like social, communal, it was administrative space, it was judicial space. So a lot of things happened, but later on, since all these other things had different institutions, it became just a place for religious activity or prayer. But at the same time, it is still a space which could be used as a communal space where people could gather. So that was one point I thought would be interesting to bring in. And as I said, that since the mosques have us, people pray in a certain direction, you'll always find that it sort of changes or shifts. And the shift is kind of interesting. That's also something I thought would be interesting to play with. And if you look into Bangladesh, there are a lot of beautiful mosques that are built out of terracotta or brick during the 13th century when Islam came to Bengal. Before that, we had Buddhist, Hindu civilizations, and then came Muslim Islam. And so we have quite a beautiful, authentic Bengali mosques, which were, you know, not in the thread anymore. So my idea was to connect that as well. So if you look into this image here, you see this is the Buddhist monasteries from 3rd century. This is a Hindu temple, that's a mosque. And this is our new religion, the democracy. So all kinds of things and all in 9 square grids in a way. And this was what I came up with, basically. That was my first conceptual drawing. The site is a square, 75 feet by 75 feet of space. One major challenge was I had no budget, so the fund had to be raised, so which means keeping it to the minimum, and minimum budget requires that you keep things, you know, even the design decisions needed to be done in a way that everything remains within that minimal aspect. All that you see here are thought of as load-bearing structure because load-bearing brick structure is the cheapest we could do. And in the center where you see the circle and then this square that you see is actually the prayer space which shifts with the axis of the mosque, or what we call Qibla. So that's the plan. That's where you enter from, on the south side. That's also the side where wind comes in. And these corners are actually kept open to sky so that there is again this draft of air that I talked about, that the building can operate on its own without any air conditioning or electricity. So that was always in mind. And all the facade is actually perforated so that it encourages airflow. These are all the different plans, sections, elevations. If you look at the model, you see these are the open courtyards on the edges that brings in light at the same time creates the ventilation. Brick on the edges, and the central space is the only space because this is the only space where we have concrete because I needed larger span without any columns in between. That's the river, which is the end of the Dhaka city border, and the mosque is somewhere here. And you see how it got built over time, that it's not a landscape of agriculture anymore. This was the beginning of the mosque with a little prayer, and this is what it looks like now. So that tree, everything, you see the difference? It's an entirely village landscape, and now it's all built up. So that's actually the mosque. You see the perforation, you see that it's still a place which is in the making. The settlement is not entirely complete. And one thing is important to see is that this is going to turn into a very dense neighborhood. So a building is already there at the back. There will be another building coming up here, maybe another one here. So at the end, you won't see the facade of the building anymore. It doesn't make any sense to make a facade or a beautiful, gorgeous building. You need to look within. That's how it is. You need to look within, and in a way, mosque is something or any spiritual space which is about connecting with the divine, or let's say, between here and infinity, or today and eternity. It's always about looking within. So that's the idea was that you look within and not without. Even the roads are not yet built, so it's all very... And brick... And light, basically, as I'm looking within, I had to also explore the idea of light. And light is something that actually gives that spiritual character to this whole space. And the situation of light actually changes, obviously, throughout the day and through the season as well. So it's not the same. Every day it's a different light. Every day is a different atmosphere altogether. So this is just a time-lapse image which actually shows over a day how the light actually changes through time, and it's kind of an interesting spiritual space if you go there. And I don't think it is a space which is only for one particular religion or a space which is only could be used as a mosque, but it's a space which could be used for many other reasons or purposes. And one thing I think it's important to mention, because Andreas put it pretty big in this flyer that he made, that it's about minaret and domes. Well, as I said, I have showed you the image of the first mosque in Islam, and it does not have any dome or minarets. Minarets and domes actually came much later, as it became sort of a, you know, design element to span larger spaces. You need a dome at some point. That was the only technique that was available. Now we have so much more to offer to span a big space. Minarets were introduced so that you could make people hear the call for prayer, which you can do without even now. So the idea was that to avoid all kind of symbolic elements that are associated with mosques today, that actually people think that that is what it is. And in a way, my intention was, and I think I find this a very compelling quotation, that quintessence of tradition is not in worshipping ashes, but preserving the fire. So for me, these elements which are symbolic in a way are the ashes. And if you want to preserve the fire, It's about the spirituality. It's about the quality of your connection with the divine if you are a believer. So that's what should be more in focus rather than having these extra symbolisms that actually takes away the main focus from what is religion and what the belief is of people and takes it to a totally different dimension, which is sort of ignoring the whole thing. So that's the reason why I try to avoid all these symbolic elements and try to create a space which is much more focused on light and spirituality. Coming to the last project, this is a small project, not really small, it's a project which is a very different one from all the projects that I showed you, that's why I'm keeping it to the last. This is in the southern part of Bangladesh, it's a resort project. If you see, this is the southern part of Bangladesh, this is the Bay of Bengal. These are the mangrove forests, the largest mangrove forests in the world, which is pretty much now under threat because of the global warming and the water rising. And this is actually the place where home to the Royal Bengal tigers. The site is located right here. And the idea of the client was that you bring in people to have a certain kind of a tourism to the Sundarban area. You don't see tigers so often, but it's a beautiful place to go to. And this is all delta. So if you look at the image here, this is where my site is located. And these are all rivers. There's another one going down here. And this is all farmland, delta and farmland. You see villages around, and otherwise it's very... And this is basically the image from the site, the river. And you see the banana plantations and all other kind of plantations. There is rice field. And in the winter, you see mustard fields and date palm trees. There's still cow carts. So once you're out of the city of Dhaka, you see life is so simple and in a low pace. And me as a trained architect, I do not know how to go there and build something. It's very difficult when you do not have the knowledge of the land. So the idea was to make minimum intervention. So how do you make the minimal intervention is about learning from what is there in the land. So what we did is we started a research, and we had students from Cornell University who came down to Dhaka for summer interns, and we did a survey of all the villages that are around. So if you look at this image here, as I said, it's a delta, it's very flat. And what we do is, when you build in delta, you dig ponds. So when you dig a pond, you get earth, you take the earth out, and you create mounds. And on the mound, you actually build your houses. So what happens is you create a small undulations. When it rains, the water gets to the ponds, so the land remains dry. So there are these small, like we don't have as you have beautiful mountain and our undulation in the land. So we create these smaller undulations to help the topography design in a way that it creates that effect of taking water in. So this is what you see here, one village where basically what you have is small rooms made out of mud. And these mud rooms are clustered around courtyards. And these courts are not distinctly defined courts, but these are spaces that are flowing from one to the other. So this is like one family house where one is gathered around courtyards. And so this we thought is an interesting idea of working with the topography. Material at the same time, and this is kind of a idyllic image in a Bangladeshi child's mind. Whenever you ask them to draw a village home, this is what they will draw. I drew it myself. I mean, this is not my drawing, but I would have drawn similar something when I was a kid. There's a house, a hut, a banana tree behind, sun going down, water body right next to the house. So this is something very idyllic as an image which exists. And that's something we thought would be interesting to work with. And this is again another image that you see. These are the roof form, which is known as the Bangla roof, from where the word bungalow comes from. So when the British went to Bengal, and this is where this whole notion of bungalow came out. Now bungalow has turned into something else, but this is the genesis of it. So I thought that would be an interesting thing to revive, because this roof doesn't exist in our landscape anymore. So this is what it is. You have a road network which comes down here. We thought of bringing in the guests from this point with a boat ride, bringing them to the site, and then to disperse them over here. And initially, this was my plan, master plan, before we did the survey. And later on, when we did the survey, we changed it to something like that, where we scattered the bungalows all over. And we had these are the huts, and you have them surrounding the courtyard. All mud, built-in mud. So these are 30-inch thick mud walls, and bamboo and thatch. That's the reception, restaurant, and all that other activities. One major thing that we've done in this project is that we've included the community. So what you've seen as drawings are drawn by my office and me, and then later on we just gave it to the villagers, and the villagers are making the whole project. So we have the plans, but the rest of it is done by them. The thing is, in Bangladesh, especially in the rural areas and in the deltas, what you see is that these young men, women, they're always looking to the city. They want to come out of their small villages, go to the city, finding a job, and staying there, and you know, entering into a strata in the city, which is absolutely at the lowest level, going into a slum, which is not really a life in that sense. But if they would stay in their own land, which is they do not do because of the fact that the pride of place is totally lost. So that's what we kind of thought it would become a program for us, that we try to revive what is pride and place. So this boy that you see, he's working for us now in the project, comes from the potter's village. So his family is actually making pottery. That's his grandfather. And you see the pottery that they generally make. And what we did is we employed him, and we said we need potteries for different reasons in the project. So we gave them different designs and to deal with. And this boy, he actually doesn't know how to make a pottery, because he never tried it. He was always looking towards the city to go and start his life. Now he has to sort of, in a way, connect with his grandfather to learn the skill that has already lost. And so now what we've done is created this connection between the older generation and the younger generation, so that they can come together and help us in the process, and at the same time can start taking over the project. So in a way, we try to build up this connection and a sense of pride and sense of ownership into the project, because that's very important when you go in a village-like place, building a resort where you expect foreigners and people from the cities will come and live or stay for a few days, and they need to connect with the locals. So this is how it's getting built now. Villagers building these huts and thatch roof, mud architecture entirely, and a lot of women work in the whole site and the project. So basically, the villagers are building this whole project. It's entirely a different project in the sense that what I've showed you. In the beginning, I was not even sure if you can call this architecture. But you know, I think this is probably the only answer I had in that location, in this dynamics that exists in that land. So this is what the project is looking now. It's growing slowly, and well, this is during the dry season or winter. This is during the same space in monsoon. So these are basically huts built by villagers and slowly coming to an end, and hopefully we'll be able to finish it by next year. That's just my site visit a few months back when it was a beautiful monsoon rain. And the idea is that if you go to Delta, you must feel Delta, what is off the place. So hopefully if this is project is finished, it will probably give you that kind of a notion of being there. So this is the end. I hope I didn't bore you, but yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Marina, for this beautiful lecture. I can imagine that there are some questions in the audience. So if you have one, please give me a sign. I can come with this microphone. It has some wire, so I can go as large as it can. And if you're not, you come to me. You want some time to think about? Then I ask her a question that I had, hearing you talk. I think this is very interesting to see this last project in contrast to the ones before, because you become aware, and I also understood and learned this from our conversations in the past, that Bangladesh has an extreme divide between the urban footprint and the landscape. I mean, it's for us, a city with 17 million people is hard to conceptualize as a city, right? The overall population is 120 million, you said.
Okay. Right.
That means it's a sixth of the population of the whole country lives in one city.
In one city.
For Switzerland, we have 7 million people. That would mean Bern would need to have 1.2 million inhabitants. It's slightly less, right? I'm wondering, you show this exponential growth, and I read that between 2005 and 2015, the city doubled in size from 6 million to 12 million. And now we know, now it has 17. So obviously this cannot go on forever, like, because at some point the performativity of the city breaks down. You told me already that half an hour car ride can easily be 3 hours.
Absolutely.
And so I'm wondering, as you're building in the countryside, and as you try to create reasons and economies and possibilities and opportunities for people to stay in the countryside, as opposed to flock to the city, as they have been doing so far, do you think there is a need for us to reimagine or rethink the scenario of development in the world where especially Western architects probably titillated slightly by Rem Koolhaas, have always thought, okay, we have this new urban drive, and by the middle of the century, so many percent of the, of like more than half of the population will live in cities. Could it be that we have to reinvert this kind of, let's say, a certain kind of excitement that we're all becoming so urban now? And as Rem Koolhaas once wrote in his kind of famous essay, whatever happened to Manuel, you need to help me. There's one text where he basically ends this the city, which is basically this text, which is basically a kind of embracement of urban development and urban growth. And the last text of the last sentence of the city of this text is really, the city is now more than ever, the city is all we have. There's interestingly no notion of landscape.
Right.
And it seems like the only scenario that we have left is that everybody will be living in cities. Now, it becomes clear from your presentation that this is probably going to be a nightmare.
Yeah.
Do you see any possibility for mankind to invert this scenario? Well, or are we doomed?
Yeah, well, that's what we are trying to do now. I mean, with the Bengal Institute and all the research work that we are doing at the moment, trying to take out this whole notion of bringing everything to one city, but to take out, like, you know, there are a lot of things that are like magnets, and these magnets actually bring in people. So if you could just take one magnet and put it to another place, and then that would probably, like, we have a lot of garment industry. And for no reason, a garment industry do not need to be in the city of Dhaka. Or let's say a lot of educational institutions which could really go to another place and could generate a certain kind of a new fabric. It doesn't have to be a city, but we could call it settlements. I would rather prefer calling it settlements than cities, which actually generates, let's say, a good, nice living rather than what we have in the city. And at the same time, give you a quality of life, job, opportunity, which does not make you come to the place again. So it's not about creating the suburbia, but actually making those spaces much more vibrant in terms of work. And so it's about taking these things out and dispersing them all over the land and not creating cities, but settlements. So that's what we are kind of trying to project. And this project perhaps is one such a thing that where I think if you grow pride of place, sense of ownership, wanting to be where you are, and give people opportunity to stay where they are located. Nobody wants to come to Dhaka, I mean, in the city. They are desperate because they need the living and the quality of life, basically. That's what's driving them towards the cities. So the idea is, you know, how you can take them out. And with this Dhaka nexus that we're trying to create, that you take things out of Dhaka, all the things that draws people in, and disperse them all over the country. If that could be done, I think you really take out everything, and then this whole notion of bringing everything to one place, one city, and creating all these stratas, you know, hierarchy in the city, that really doesn't need to be there at all.
Actually, this sounds like Switzerland. You know?
It does, yeah.
We did a bit of driving today, train and car, and you probably saw that we have this kind of repetition of settlements, as you say, of entities, of built stuff. And there's actually no big cities here. So would you say this is actually maybe a paradigm?
I think it is. Why not? You have a very good communication system. You could be in, I mean, you know, I can't even think of all the things that we've done in a day. It's impossible in the city of Dhaka. It's absolutely impossible. You know, going from one city to another within
an hour.
It's impossible. You cannot move from one place to another in Dhaka in an hour or so. So definitely there's something wrong with cities today. Okay. And this needs to be dispersed. And as I said, settlements, yeah.
All right. Now, any questions? Darren, there's one.
Hi.
Hi.
Firstly, thank you so much for your lecture. It was great, inspiring. It's great to be exposed to it. We're all very jealous of your non-insulated structural architecture, I have to say. I just also wanted to make a few comments and just a question. And thank you for mentioning that there is no real kind of Islamic architecture in the sense, since in the West and in the Eurocentric world, it's commonly used for anything that kind of occupies two-thirds of the world architecture. And it's equivalent to Christian architecture, which I still don't know what it means. I just have one question about your fantastic mosque. Was there in any way the requirements to separate female prayers from male prayers? And if so, did you use architectural elements or time, sort of any kind of spaces, or was that not even a topic since the space looked very sort of central or minimal?
No, not really. But we see in the subcontinent, overall Indian subcontinent, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, you don't see women going to mosque at all. They don't go to mosque because there's no culture of going to a mosque. So it's only for male. And if it's a bigger mosque, only now, very recently, maybe within the last 10, 15 years, in large, big mosques, that they actually create a space where women can go and pray. Even that is very, very small. Maybe 5 to 10 mosques in the whole of Dhaka City probably provides that. And this location where this mosque is, which is kind of half village, half city, kind of an atmosphere, where it will never happen that a woman would go to a mosque to pray. That generally would not occur. Would be nice to have a space. But the thing is, I still have a space which is on the upper level, which is now I'm suggesting as a library, a small library. But if it so happens that women can go to the mosque, then they could turn that into a space for women to go and pray. But the other idea, as I said, that this is not just to be used as a mosque, but also for other activities which can generate much more communal social atmosphere. There, definitely women are, they can come in and start using that space. So probably that might generate the interest of coming to a mosque, which doesn't have to be only for prayer, but for other reasons as well. So that's how, so far, the way we've thought about it. And, you know, with these, especially with religion, and there are a lot of different kind of taboos that you need to slowly address rather than being too radical about it. So I think it's radical enough that I did not design it like to make it look like a regular mosque that people are generally identify with, but a space which is much more than just a mosque. So let's see.
Another question? I'm here.
Yes, a very precise question. Which kind of technique did you use in the last? Is just adobe bricks and clay?
Well, those are sun-dried mud bricks. So it's a big project. So it's we had to employ, generally in the Delta, you don't see mud bricks being used. It's basically mud mixed with straw dust and cow dung and lots of other things that they make, and then they layer them. And that's a very slow process. And with small houses, that's possible. But when we have a bigger project like that, what we did is we took bricks, which did not go into the kiln to get baked. So it's just regular sun-dried brick. We took them from close by brick kilns and just took them, and so that we could employ regular contractors. So that was something we brought out. So basically the people who are working in that area, we trained them, so they are using mud bricks and mud plaster and mud mortar and creating that out of that thing. So yeah.
Noch eine Frage? Hier ist eine. Jetzt kommen die Grenzen.
Sorry. I think it's quite unusual to be a woman and an architect. So are there more architectural women in Dhaka, or are you the only one?
Oh my God. No. We have almost 50-50.
Wow, yeah. I didn't.
Yeah, there's a big architecture community of women, actually.
That's yes. Good to hear.
Yes. Yeah. Very rarely you see them coming into practice, but there are a lot of women in practice, maybe with partnership with others. But like me, I'm a principal of an office and I practice on my own. This is a bit rare, but there are, even then, there would be another 10, 12 practices which are like that, that run by women only. But otherwise, there are a lot of women. Most of my office, the architects working for me are women. So, yeah, we have a lot.
Yeah.
Okay. Another question? Should we wrap up? Maybe we continue the discussion with the rest of the drinks.
Yeah.
I would like again to thank the Hans and René Müller-Mehlein Stiftung for this wonderful support that they enable us to make this series. And the next lecture in this series will be next year. And Marina, I actually thought of something. As opposed to us nominating the next speaker, could you do that? Could you find an architect that you find worthwhile for us to have a look at and to get to know? Because we might not, you know, not find someone like, or like we would probably find someone, you know, that is in our magazines already. And it would, I would like to use your eyes, your perspective of the world, and to tell us, yeah, look at this architect, and I'd be really happy to be surprised. Could you imagine?
You don't want me to tell it now, right?
No. Okay, take your time. It's next year, so we have a couple of months, and we see each other in December in Dakar, and then that's great. So maybe we'll make this the principle of this whole series. I would like to, also das kann ich auf Deutsch sagen, ich würde gerne noch die Aufmerksamkeit erregen auf die Ausstellung, die wir gerade haben. Das ist die erste Ausstellung, die wir jetzt mit unserem neuen Team machen. Ich möchte mich auch sehr bei meinem Team bedanken für die Vorbereitung und Organisation dieser Veranstaltung. Die Imagine la Suisse-Ausstellung läuft gerade. Das ist, wie gesagt, unsere erste Ausstellung, die wir jetzt machen. An der Fassade, weil wir erstmal in den öffentlichen Raum gehen wollen. Wir wollen mit unserem Publikum kommunizieren. Wir wollen wissen, wer ist eigentlich unser Publikum? Wer könnte es werden? Wir wollen wissen, womit wir uns beschäftigen in den nächsten Jahren. Da spielt die Schweiz eine große Rolle, aber nicht nur. Es geht genauso um Orte, die ganz weit weg sind, wo wir nicht so leicht hinreisen können. Und am 18.11. gibt es, wie gesagt, unsere erste Ausstellung, die wir dann innerhalb unserer Räumlichkeiten machen, indem wir gerade ein neues Lichtsystem einbauen lassen. Deswegen können wir die Räume im Moment nicht bespielen, aber wir haben ja die Straße. Und das ist dann die Ausstellung schweizweit, in der wir zum ersten Mal versuchen, seit längerer Zeit ein Gefühl zu bekommen, was ist eigentlich Schweizer Architektur heute, wo wir 161 Büros präsentieren mit sehr diversen Positionen und wo wir versuchen, vielleicht eine neue Programmatik der Schweizer Architektur zu eruieren im Lauf der Ausstellung mit einer Reihe von diskursiven Veranstaltungen, wo wir insgesamt 25 Büros einladen werden, zu erzählen, was sie tatsächlich bewegt in ihrer Arbeit, und wo wir vielleicht am Ende der Ausstellung nächsten Mai ein Bild bekommen von Schweizer Architektur, das sich eben seit den 90er Jahren vielleicht doch weiterentwickelt hat, über die Schweizer Kiste hinaus. Und ich lade Sie alle herzlich ein, damit zu kommen und den Neuanfang des Schweizer Architekturmuseums zu feiern. Vielen, vielen Dank.